Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org. Today we talk about 5 primary key mappings you should know while working with JPA and Hibernate. You will learn how to generate unique numeric primary key values, use and generate UUIDs as primary keys, map composite primary keys, share primary keys in one-to-one associations, and how to use Hibernate's proprietary mapping of natural IDs. But before we dive deeper into today's topics, if this is your first time here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and all types of other Java persistence related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Okay, now that this is done, let's get back to today's topic. Mapping a primary key column with JPA and Hibernate is simple. You just need to add an attribute to your entity, make sure that its type and name match the database column, annotate it with ID, and you're done. You can then use the primary key to load the entity, and Hibernate sets the primary key and all other entity attribute values automatically. And if you want to persist the new entity, you need to set the primary key value programmatically. But with JPA and Hibernate, you can do much more than that. You can choose between different strategies to generate unique primary key values, use UUIDs and generate their values, map composite primary keys, share primary key values across associations, and map natural IDs. I will show you how to do all of that in this video. Let's start with the generation of numerical primary key values. Most table models use simple numerical primary keys. They are easy to use and very efficient at the same time. You can either set their values programmatically or use one of JPA's generation strategies to create them automatically. The easiest way to do that is to annotate your primary key attribute with a generated value annotation. Hibernate will then pick a strategy based on the database-specific dialect. Using the auto strategy or not referencing a strategy at all is the simplest but not the best way. It's better to specify the strategy. You can choose between auto to let Hibernate pick one of the following strategies, sequence to use a database sequence, identity to use an auto-incremented database column, table to use a database table to simulate a sequence. Specifying the strategy ensures that a Hibernate update will not accidentally change your generation strategy, and if you're using the generation type sequence, it will also activate some of Hibernate's performance optimizations. Defining the strategy is simple. You just need to provide it as a value of the strategy attribute of the generated value annotation. This mapping here tells Hibernate to use a database sequence to generate primary key values. By default, Hibernate uses a sequence called Hibernate sequence. You can also tell Hibernate to use one of your own database sequences. I explained that in more details in my Hibernate tip, how to use a custom database sequence. UUIDs and numerical primary keys might seem very different, but with Hibernate, you can map and use them in almost the same way. The only difference is the type of the primary key attribute, which is a Java util UUID instead of a Java lang long. Here's a simple example. The book entity maps an attribute of type UUID and uses one of Hibernate's generators to create primary key values automatically before persisting a new entity. This is the easiest way to map and generate a UUID as a primary key. If you want to take a more detailed look at your mapping options, please watch How to Generate UUIDs as Primary Keys with Hibernate, or you can find also a link to the corresponding article in the video description. You can then use this book entity in the same way as you would use an entity that maps a primary key attribute of type long. When Hibernate persists this book entity, it first generates a UUID, it then sets that value as the ID value in the SQL insert statement. You can see this in the log file if you activate my recommended development configuration. JPA and Hibernate also provide multiple ways to map composite primary keys that consist of multiple attributes. Let's take a look at my preferred option, the embedded ID. I explain this and all other options in great details in my advanced Hibernate online training. The embedded ID approach uses an embeddable to map the primary key attributes. An embeddable is a pure Java class that is annotated with embeddable. It defines attribute mappings in a reusable way. If you want to use it as an embedded ID, you also need to implement the equals and hashcode methods. You can then use the embeddable class as the type of your primary key attribute and annotate it with embedded ID. The embeddable and all its attributes become part of the entity. It follows the same lifecycle and all its attributes get mapped to the database table that's mapped by the entity. Another common primary key mapping is to use the same primary key value in a one-to-one association. Here you can see an example. Each manuscript belongs to one book, and each book has one manuscript. That's a typical one-to-one association, and in most table models, it gets mapped by a shared primary key value, which also acts as the foreign key. You can, of course, map this with JPA and Hibernate. The only things you need to do are to model the owning side of the association on the entity that shall reuse the primary key value and to add a maps ID annotation to it. When you persist the manuscript entity, you only need to set the association to the book entity. Hibernate will then use the primary key value of the book for the new manuscript. You can dive deeper into this mapping in my Hibernate tip, how to share the primary key in a one-to-one association. I will put the link to it to the description box, or you click on the link in the top right corner. Most teams prefer to use a surrogate key as the primary key. It's easier to manage in your code, and all involved systems can handle it more efficiently. But modeling a natural ID is still useful. You will most likely reference them very often in your use cases. Hibernate provides an annotation to declare a natural ID and an API to retrieve entities by it. Let's take a quick look at the most important details. And if you want to dive deeper, please read my article Natural ID, a good way to persist natural IDs with Hibernate. You will find a link to it below. You can specify a natural ID by annotating one or more entity attributes with natural ID. I use it in the code to tell Hibernate that the ISBN attribute is a natural ID of the book entity. After you've done that, you can use the byNaturalID method on Hibernate session interface to create a query that loads an entity by its natural ID. If you're using JPA's entity manager, you can get the corresponding session interface by calling the unwrap method. In the next step, you need to provide the value of the natural ID by calling the using method for each attribute that's part of the natural ID. In this example, the natural ID only consists of the ISBN attribute, which I reference using the JPA metamodel class of the book entity. And after you provided the natural ID value, you can call the load method to execute the query. When you run this code and activate the logging of SQL statements, you can see that Hibernate first gets the primary key value for the provided natural ID. It then executes a second query to load the entity by its primary key. The result of the first query gets cached so that Hibernate doesn't need to perform it again. As you can see, JPA and Hibernate can do much more than just mapping a numerical primary key column to an entity attribute. You can use them to generate unique primary key values, to map and create UUIDs, to work with composite primary keys, and to use the same primary key value for associated entities. And Hibernate also supports natural primary keys with its own proprietary query mechanism. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a cheat sheet for this video, several ebooks about JPA and Hibernate, and a video course. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!